Basics of digital camera controls. Color space. It refers to the number of colors your camera will store. sRGB stands for small red, green, blue, which is the best setting for those shooting only in JPEG file format. Adobe RGB is a bigger color space and is better choice for those that process their own image using Photoshop or other image editing program prior to having them printed. Images taken with sRGB look more vivid straight off the camera because the camera processes the files for you. Adobe RGB color space is better when you use RAW files. The image initially tend to look flat, but after processing with Adobe Photoshop, they can look better than JPEG files. If you shoot RAW, stay your camera to Adobe RGB. If you shoot just JPEG files, leave your camera on sRGB mode. Exposure meter. These days, you will find that almost all digital camera have several type of metering modes. What they do is they all measure light reaching your digital sensor. The metering system choices are a multi-segmented or evaluative matrix honeycomb setting. So, all are one, like it could be named as multi-segmented or evaluative or matrix or honeycomb. B, the center weighted average setting, the spot meter. For most part, you can keep your camera on the evaluative metering setting and it should work just fine. The third setting, the spot meterings, takes time and practice to master, and you will only need it when you are working with backlit subjects and poor lighting conditions. Exposure compensation. Sometimes even the best light meters can be fooled if the background is really bright or really dark. Many digital camera offer the ability to alter exposure by making the picture lighter or darker using an exposure compensation button. The manual will tell you whether your camera has the standard exposure compensation button marked by a plus minus sign besides it, or whether you will need to access the function through the menu. The exposure compensation makes a significant difference to the image, which is why it is one of the first control you should grasp well. Histogram. The histogram feature is used to evaluate exposure, particularly in bright light outdoors. The height of histogram represents number of pixels in your picture with a particular tone. If the histogram is too far left, the picture may be underexposed. If it is too far to the right, the picture is overexposed. Overexposure is the worst thing you can do because it cannot be fixed afterwards. A good histogram is balanced as much as possible. Study your owner's manual to learn how to access the histogram and evaluate exposure levels. ISO speed. The ISO speed determines the digital sensor sensitivity to light and the amount of noise in your pictures. In bright light, for instance, when it's sunny, you should use an ISO speed between 100 to 200. If you want to shoot inside without using a flash, then set your camera to ISO 400, 800, and with lot of caution 1600 or higher. The higher the ISO speed, the noisier your image will be. If you don't understand, it is some kind of graininess in your photos. Cheaper cameras or less expensive cameras change the ISO speed automatically. Little better camera have a control on ISO sensitivity. But really, to master the digital photography medium, you should control the ISO speed on your own. When we go out in different kind of light coming from different sources, the amount of red and blue differs between the time of the day or the type of the light you are using. Our eyes are so good that they always adjust themselves to that ambience or that overriding color or something. But the camera can't do that. We have to tell them either that in what color balance we are shooting, and to tell them there is a setting which is called white balance. It refers to the color of the light you are shooting in. If you are shooting indoors, the light tend to be warmer or yellow in color because of the tungsten light bulb, if you are using tungsten light bulbs. If you are shooting outside, the light often has a greater amount of blue and a picture can appear cold. This coldness would also depend on the time of the day. Early morning, you have most cold kind of light. Late evening would have very, very warm light. To get most accurate colors, you want to match your white balance to the type of light you are shooting under. If you are shooting JPEG file, it's an important to match the white balance as close as possible. Sometime auto white balance, AWB, will work fine. But if you are not happy with the results, set the white balance manually. If you are shooting RAW file, it is possible to change the white balance afterward in the software. So I usually just leave my camera set to auto white balance. And if I am using RAW file, but I am very, very careful with it when I am using JPEGs. Custom white balance is usually used in a studio photography. White balance symbol, if shooting a JPEG file, either use AWB for even better result, settle white balance to match the lighting under which you are taking a photograph. If you are shooting RAW files, I recommend using AWB and then fine tune the white balance opening in the file in Adobe Photoshop or similar programs. Getting started with a digital camera. Understanding and appreciating digital photography. The first step is to read your camera manual. I know it's not the most exciting thing to do, especially when you have just got a new camera and you can't wait to use it. But your manual really is the most comprehensive guide to your specific equipment, and it's the best place to start. Now that you have the theory and technique covered, what's next? Learning to apply it all in practice. Start taking pictures around your home or backyard and play with the various features. Take a lot of pictures, experiment, play and have fun with your camera. The practice really makes perfect. The more experience you get, the better photograph you will be able to take. Vision and seeing are the most important element of photography. It helps to have talent and instinctive aesthetic sense that there are no substitute for practice, hard work and active learning. You become a good photographer by shooting often, studying the work of other photographers and artists, and thinking about what is you that you want to show in your pictures. There is no photography lesson quite like taking photographs and then looking at it and understanding what works and what doesn't. Tapping the right resources will help you hone your skills. This is where we come in. Utilizing the knowledge and experience of the expert is a great way to access your own work from another, with more learned perspective. You should consider signing up for a beginner workshop, a course or a private training. Pick up some book on photography at your local library or local store. The internet is the most extensive, accessible, cheapest resource of the modern age, and you can log on to YouTube, photography forums and website to learn more. Composing photographs. The first step to composing a good photograph is selecting your subject. Usually, the subject is most obvious aspect of any photograph. But once you have got the main focus down, you need to take the time to get all the other aspects of picture right. Composing a good photo requires calculating everything from position of the subject and the number of subjects to the background and how different aspects of the scene interact with one another. For a starter, don't try to add too many elements in your picture. Put the main subject smack in the middle. There are rookie mistakes. You can start experimenting once you are more experienced. You don't try to do too much or balance a picture too perfectly at the onset. If you start out with too many rigid categories right at the beginning, you are going to be trapped by your own rules. Putting things in middle sometime works, but there are better places to place your most important subject. Get closer to your subject and check if there is anything in the view that doesn't need to be there. Ask yourself what is important in the picture and what do you want to show or communicate. Sometimes just moving in closer or a little to one side can result in significantly better pictures. Simply as much as you can, if you are shooting a landscape, avoid putting the horizon in the middle of the frame. Either move the horizon down to emphasize the sky or move it up in the frame to emphasize the foreground. You can make an exception when you have shooting a body of water, want to capture symmetrical reflections. When photographing people or animal, you should avoid them in center of the frame. It's better to move them off to the side. Photographers often refer to the rule of thirds, which is simply a guide to improve composition by moving your subject away from the center of the frame and near one of the point of intersection. Some of photographs divide the frame into third and place important element at an intersection, and this can result in more effective pictures. If your camera has guidelines, you might want to try and turn them on for a while until you develop a knack for composing picture on their own. You will find that it is easier to hold the camera horizontally, but you must experiment with the composition. Landscape work better in horizontal frame, but portrait really pop up in vertical frames. If you have the time, try to capture all your subject in both horizontal and vertical frame format and check later to see which you or your client likes better. Taking close-ups, you should try on the monitor. It is a great way to compose and focus the images, since it shows the scene exactly the way it will be in the image. You will capture an optical viewfinder doesn't allow the same view because it is offset from the lens. Often photographing over a crowd at ground level or a ground corner, a camera with tilting or swirling monitor let you compose images without holding the camera up to your eye. The monitor gets its image directly from the image sensor, so shows the view seen through the lens. Most show the entire image. The monitor often gives you a preview of low light or dark the captured will be. This lets you use the flash or adjust the exposure you make in the way you want it. Capturing photographs. One of the biggest hurdles to capture good photograph is the issue of delays. The time we take between identifying a moment, deciding to capture it, using the camera and waiting on the equipment to respond can cause potentially fantastic photos end up being just okay photos. One of my favorite photographers, Henri Cartier-Bresson, is known for his ability to capture images at just the right moment. Do you know his secret? Always being ready. If you practice enough to become one of your camera, it won't just be a tool you use, it will be an extension of you as a person and an artist. There will be no time lost while fumbling to get control right. Digital cameras are generally equipped with autofocus and exposure option along with preset shooting modes, so you can save a lot of time on settings. The more advanced camera in the market come with exhaustive settings and features, which basically mean that we have to let equipment do its work. Of course, it goes without saying that more advanced a camera is, the more expensive it is going to be. A skill you must develop is the ability to identify and predict photo-worthy moment and subject. It is both a technical and intuitive skill. If you can hone this particular skill, half your problem while shooting will be nullified. Once you identify a potential moment, you should quickly compose the image and press the shutter button halfway down to lock focus and exposure. Wait for the moment to occur, and when it does, just press the button down fully and get the image. You should know that this particular technique uses up more of the battery charge, but it is a small price to pay for getting the photo you want, isn't it? Another important aspect of getting good photo is working on the image quality. Holding the camera properly can make a big difference. You should hold the camera close to your face with your elbows tucked in, feet spread apart, with one foot slightly forward. Try this trick when you shoot. Hold your breath for a moment. If you lean on a wall, fence, or other objects, this can help you steady your camera. You can also use tools such as bean bags, monopods, and tripods. They will allow you to support your camera and get sharper pictures. Editing. One of the best things about shooting in the digital format is the scope for manipulation and correcting later. All you need is a good photo editing software program on your computer. From improving a photo along the classic matrix like sharpness, brightness, removing flaws, to getting really creative with funky effects, you can do so much while editing your pictures. Editing photo not only involves changing the way an image looks, but also adopting it to other technical considerations, such as making it smaller for emails or posting on a website. Now we are going to take a look at some of the things you can do with a photo editing software. You can change the side and orientation of the image. You can add or remove number of pixels in the images to change the size. You can crop an image to remove distracting, unimportant part of the image. Cropping can also be used to fit an image into a specific design, such as newsletter, letter, greeting cards. The orientation can be changed by rotating the image. You can edit the tonal range of a photograph if you aren't happy with the contrast. The tonal range is the brightness in an image between pure white and pure black. Once you take a photo, evaluate its tonal range, either by simply judging what you are seeing or by using the histogram function. Why do you need to adjust the tonal range? Image that you use the full tonal range look rich and crisp with vibrant colors and a smooth transition in tones. Those that don't use the full range lack contrast, often look flat and dull. Detail may be missing in the highlights and shadows areas, or the image may be too dark or light. Another way you can change image is to edit the color. The human eye perceives colors in terms of three characteristics: hue, saturation, and brightness. By playing around with these three aspects of color, you can harmonize the imbalanced color, color cast, and lights in the image. Editing out flaw and imperfection in some time, just about everyone does. Professional photographers edit out the tiniest imperfection before delivering the finished product to their clients, while the lay person edit to make sure that selfie look flattering. There is a very little you can't correct with the editing. Dark spot caused by dust on the sensor annoying you, an untimely blemish on the face embarrassing you, unsightly objects and busy background distracting focus from the main subject. You can also try out the tagged image file format, which is called TIFF, which is a file format that is often used to exchange file between applications and computer platforms. It is supported by virtually all paint, image editing, and page layout applications. TIFF file tend to be larger than both JPEG and RAW files and can be saved using either 8-bit or 16-bit per color. Choosing image sizes. On the internet, images are displayed on a screen that have resolution of 1280x1024, 1152x864, 1024x768, or 800x600, or 640x480. A few years ago, 1024x768 monitor was unusual, so most people in the industry settled on assuming that lowest common denominator for screen size was 640x480 or 800x600. For this reason, images to be emailed or posted on the internet should be of similar or smaller sizes. This ensures that the images will display correctly on the vast majority of computers. If an image is too large, the people you send it to will not be able to see it all at once and will be forced to scroll around it. If too small, detail will be lost. Size also affects the speed with which images travel over the internet. Smaller and more compressed images travel faster, so people see them more quickly. For laser and inkjet printer, you need between 200 to 300 image pixel per inch. If your camera can capture images that are 2400 pixel wide, you can expect good result when prints are up to 12 inches wide. When images are printed on a printing press, they might be for a catalog. The pixels in the image are printed as dot on the page. Photographs are to be printed on a press are first digitally screened to break the image up into dots. If you are ever involved in this process, your print shop will give you the specification for your images. Sharing digital photographs. Once an image is the way you want it, you will find that there are many ways to display and share it. These include printing it on almost anything from art paper to coffee mugs, inserting it into documents, posting it on a photo sharing website or a blog, emailing it, including it in a printed book or a slideshow that plays on a DVD player connected to the TV or a DVD drive in a computer, or display it in a digital photo frame. Sharing digital photographs on a screen. Those of us enjoy photography know that one of the best part of being able to share our work with people, giving and receiving creativity, beauty and art, not to mention all the hard work that goes into it, is a driving force behind most of the photographers. If you are looking to share your digital photograph with other people without moving the image off the digital format, there are several things you can do. For starters, you can share your photos by sending them to people via email services, instant messengers, and peer-to-peer sharing services. Another great way of using digital photo is to carry them on an on-screen display such as slideshows and presentation on TV or computers or projectors in a digital photo frame as a screensaver and digital wallpaper for your computers. If you want to share your photos with a large audience, publish them online. From photo sharing websites and apps like Instagram to your social media accounts and photo blogs, from RSS feed and ebooks to your own personal or business website, there are so much ways in which you can use your digital images. Sharing your digital photographs in print. Now, if you are interested in taking your work offline, the sky is limit. You can get your photos printed, framed, mounted, and more. From photo album and coffee table books to the wall art, posters and scrapbook, there's no need and there's no end to creativity. Do you know what most common denominators for judging photos quality is? The sharpness. The trained eye might pick out other aspect of a photograph, but at first glance, just about everyone responds to a photograph in terms of how clear and crisp it is. When you use editing software to sharpen a photo, you are basically increasing the contrast along the lines and edges. What do you do if a picture is too grainy and you don't intend to be that way? Or if it is a photograph is obviously pixelated in a way that is stand out harshly? These things happen if you accidentally use a long shutter speed or high ISO setting to take a photograph. The noise in the image can easily be edited out for a smoother finish. If you are dissatisfied with the light in a photo, if the shadows or highlights are too intense or too pale and affecting the quality of the image, you can adjust the exposure to achieve a desired balance. Just be careful not to overexpose highlight, otherwise they'll become too bright and will lose details or will become rimmed in flare of colors.